I wake up in a sticky sweat to a stifling heat. Waves wash more garbage onto the beach just meters from my bed. It takes me a moment to realize where I am, to remember that I'm in Haiti, in the tiny village of McDonald, the poorest place I've ever been.
I kind of did it to myself, but I totally just got really scared. It doesn't make any rational sense, but it was like real fear. It just made me feel so vulnerable. Like, you don't realize how sort of safe we feel in our homes, and then here, and you're just kind of like in the middle of this unknown land.
My name is Emily Beers. And this morning, I find myself with three fellow travelers in the most impoverished nation of the Americas. Together, we're here to attempt to make a difference in any small way we can. And there's one man in this village who is key to making this happen.
Yeah, I'm very happy to see you.
Yeah.
When Julie told me I will be in Haiti with some friends, how good to meet your friends. So where's all your friends?
Yeah.
This is Gabriel Nixon. He's kind of everything around here. He's the unofficial mayor of McDonald, the principal of the local school, and sometimes one of its teachers. He also runs an old age home, which he refers to as the house for old. In Haiti, life expectancy is 61 years old. So by the time you're 50, you are considered an elder and can expect to live in a house for old. By the time we leave Haiti, we will learn that Gabriel is one of the most generous, selfless, purely good human beings any of us have ever met.
How are the pitch projects going now that we've
had? Well,
yeah.
In Africa and in Haiti, what we've done is sort of focused on microcredit loans, which we call pay it forward loans.
Everything is well. People pay back.
They're paying.
Pay back. Good.
So how many do we have now?
We have 24.
From five, because we only started with five.
Yes.
Now, wow, that's 24. Incredible. There's 24. That's amazing.
Basically, we're making a small investment to people that can't afford a business, and they buy maybe a sewing machine to sew clothes to sell, or they would buy livestock to sell. And what they end up doing with the capital is, as they make profit, they pay the loan forward to their neighbor, to somebody else nominated in the community, and so it grows exponentially.
It's the problem we have in Haiti now. We need to start. When? We need to start. Now is the time. We can raise it, and you have the same life. The people need to know how they can work together to have a better life.
I think what microfinance serves to do is that instead of turning someone into a dependent on the international community, what it ends up doing is empowering the individual to realize, if I put in the hard work, I can better my condition in the long run.
Okay, thank you. We'll come out in 5 minutes.
Okay. In Creole. See you later. Now a pita.
Now a pita.
Yes.
Now a pita. Okay. Now a pita.
Okay.
Here we go. Ready?
We set off on a tour of the community to check up on the various projects Julie's group has funded. This is our first time leaving the concrete walls of our house, and we're a bit apprehensive. Our first stop is the small pig farm Julie funded last year. One of the pigs she purchased for the family recently had a litter of piglets, which means the family's small business is about to flourish.
We start with three pigs. One of them died, and we have two pigs and six little pigs. And later, when the little is ready to leave the mother, we can give to other people in the community.
Okay.
We're happy with this project. When we see the little, that can give us hope.
Of course.
It's amazing how something small like a litter of pigs can bring so much hope to an entire village.
With the microloans, what they've done is they've given people a certain sense of empowerment and the fact that they can take ideas and take control of their own lives as opposed to just sitting around waiting for something to happen.
One of Julie's other big concerns for McDonald is sanitation. Since most families here don't have bathrooms, garbage beach or the filthy stream that runs through McDonald often substitutes as a toilet.
Because there isn't adequate access to clean water and there's not appropriate bathrooms in people's houses. So we've also had a project to dig latrines for poor families in Haiti.
This is the pilot project latrine that they built, I think, last year. And so four families use it. It kind of looks like just a, I don't know how it's in here. Doesn't even, oh, never mind. That does kind of smell.
We take a look at the latrines in progress. What strikes me right away is the heat. No amount of water could possibly keep you hydrated working in these conditions. The saving grace of this site is its relatively soft soil. The same is not true of the next one.
You see how functional we actually are. Oh my God, that's so pretty though.
The view below is a contradictory mix of both beauty and devastation.
The best view in this whole town is going to be from sitting on this toilet when it's done. Look at that.
The barren landscape of the former French colony used to be lush and green. But when Haiti was granted independence, they paid their debt to France in trees. And by 2006, less than 2% of Haiti's trees remained.
I'm just trying to take it all in, really, at the moment. It's very surreal. We used to stay in sort of old towns in Mexico, and it's a lot like this, but nowhere near.
Next, we check out the site of the future community school, whose construction is temporarily on hold because of a lack of funds. Near the school, we meet a family. The exhausted mother hides her infected eye, while her children capture my heart in a nanosecond. Her older son, who can't be more than 4, has a giant lump protruding from his navel. This means he has worms from drinking contaminated water. On this island, it seems like every other child has worms. It's amazing to think that this village is the only reality this little guy might ever know.
What a different life that little baby has compared to what we're used to. It makes our lives almost seem really, really trivial with the stuff that we deal with and the stuff that we see as problems. We have to deal with more important things, I guess, just, you know, surviving.
Bonjour tout le monde.
Bonjour,
yes. How are we?
Yes.
Yes. Nous venons avec une délégation qui sort du Canada.
The final leg of our journey is to the local school. Although Gabriel is the principal, he's a born teacher and loves getting involved in classes. In McDonald, going to school is optional, even for the youngest children. In fact, half the population never learns to read. Gabriel believes getting children to attend and stay in school is key to helping Haiti out of poverty.
We try to teach them that here is the best place for you, for them now. And later you can, they can have a better life if they accept to stay in recent. Here, something here can help them during their life. Yes. Okay. Do you want to learn class questions?
That was unbelievable. It was fast. It was so much. I couldn't believe it. People are very genuinely excited to have us here. And they're just excited to share with us a little bit of their lives. And it's very humbling. This has been quite the experience so far.
After a long morning, Julie takes us to the one beach in the area where they allegedly clean up the garbage. Well, we thought this was the case, until one of us almost stepped on a syringe that washed up on shore. More than anything, though, being here revealed the potential this place really has, syringes and all. And later tonight, we'll learn that the undeniable aesthetic beauty of this island is only the beginning. The real potential is in the people.
C'est toujours un plaisir pour nous
de rencontrer.
Et je dis à nous en délégation
de
nous commencer par la prière.
What we do, we always start with prayer.
Dieu tout-puissant.
I don't remember the last time I went to church back home. And here I am in a church in Haiti, surrounded by Creole-speaking Haitians. They treat us like the guests of honor, which feels so bizarre, given that all we've done is walk around and ride Julie's coattails. What's even more amazing is that in all of Julie's 12 trips to McDonald, this is the first time the community is meeting the woman behind the Pay It Forward loan projects that have touched so many of their lives.
Amen.
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 Well, I just wanted to say thank you. Everybody that came today. I have been coming for 2.5 years. And I've never seen all of you together like
this.
I think when I saw all the community members together in a church staring up at me, and to hear the leader of the community talk about how much we've changed their life, and they actually believe that they can change the course of their community. And maybe it's still just one community, but if it can change this community and grow to villages around, and they actually have faith and belief in their future, I can't even really adequately express how much that it just makes it all worth it.
We feel so welcome on this trip.
Nous sentons bien.
And these are my friends. Their first time in Haiti.
It's been the sense of deeply rooted connection that people here feel towards each other, and the way they've extended that to us. Because I know had they, say, come to Canada in a reverse situation, their reception would be nowhere near as warm as the one that we've received.
And I want to say thank you so much for the wonderful reception you have given.
And I think I found that to a certain degree to be very inspiring.
Okay, nous dis merci avec l'équipe ça. On va donner la bonne bravo pour vous. Bravo.
But the people here, their first allegiance is to Gabriel, to the man who brings the hope. When he speaks, his people listen. When he speaks, his people look instantly more hopeful. He is a man with the potential to lift this community out of poverty, a man who is lifting this community to a better place, all because he believes they can be better.
That we can be better.
Yes,
we can.
You just wouldn't see that back home, like the whole community coming together to greet these 5 foreigners who are, you know, there to, I guess, help them out. But that doesn't happen at home. It's so weird.
And of course, Julie, generous as she is, funded a meal for everyone in attendance. Gabriel is concerned that a food riot might break out, and he does his best to settle the crowd.
Once something like food gets in the way, it's kind of like a mob mentality that it turns into. Just kind of trying to survive, basically.
As soon as the sandwiches arrive, the crowd grows restless. The air is tense, but just for a moment. For the most part, people are happy and calm. They sit and enjoy their bean paste sandwiches.
Kane, like, scarfed his down. I wasn't sure what I was putting into my mouth there. It didn't taste bad. It was kind of unknown food.
By the time we leave the town hall meeting, The sun is setting and the temperature is more bearable. As we walk home, we're greeted over and over by everyone we pass. And pretty soon, the streets come alive. Never is the contrast of this land more evident than when you watch kids play. You could be in any city in the world. Their pure, innocent joy is a beautiful thing. A thing kids seem to share no matter where they grow up. But these same kids, carefree as they are, live in dire poverty. They live in a world where salty refried bean sandwiches, if that's what they even were, are something to be thankful for. Kids don't play like this anymore where I come from, on the streets until all hours of the night. People back home don't look after their neighbors' children. If a Haitian showed up in Canada, nobody would notice. But a Canadian in Haiti gets cooked for, invited to their town hall meeting, and even asked to play. A Canadian in Haiti gets taken in and taken care of and introduced to what it means to be Haitian. The spirit of the people here is about accepting the struggles of life, all the while embracing the gift of simply being alive. Already in 2 days, I have learned so much, including how to successfully skip double dutch.